might hide or anything.
What thing?
One question at a time.
I have been housekeeper for many years. I know no other room or area of the chateau.
They say it's afraid of gunfire.
Who, Herr Frankenstein?
No, not him.
Victor, what are you doing?
Only one turkey snakes back to the maid.
They're back.
Come on. Give them a couple minutes. Sanity?
Just
do as I tell you.
No guests, no reception, police everywhere. Not my kid, a wedding night.
Should I reckon Sophie?
What on earth for?
I thought you might want something to eat or drink.
No, nothing. Victor, now that we're married, won't you tell me what's getting hold of you? You've been so distraught. When I speak, I'm not sure you hear what I say. When I look at you, I know your thoughts are elsewhere.
Forgive me a little bit. I have so much to be forgiven for.
You don't regret marrying me.
I am afraid.
Afraid of what? Victor, you must tell me. You've lived these past months with some terrible private dread. I want to bring you happiness. I am Frau Frankenstein, the wife of a brilliant young scientist. Whatever troubles you, has to trouble me. I beg you, Victor, take me into your confidence. What's out there that frightens you?
Tonight. This very night, the man who will kill me will come through the garden.
What are you saying?
I know it's not incredible. Monsters, all the same, it's true.
Who would want to kill you? Why?
I ask only that you remember your love for me when you hear my words.
Go on.
Do you remember when I returned from the university at Ingolstadt?
Of course. You were in such poor health, and we were all so very worried for you.
I didn't want to return. I wanted to find some icy glacier and build a funeral pyre. If not for myself, then for my deed. I hadn't slept in days.
How are you?
Constant. My temper is almost violent. My moods vary between deep depression and melancholia.
Oh, come, Victor, you're away from your gloomy university. What could be more pleasant than a holiday on the shores of Lake Geneva? In one's own chateau.
Holiday? Call it retreat. Sanctuary, anything but holiday. I appreciate your good spirits, and I know you're trying to cheer me up. Can't be much fun for anyone having me about like this.
Had a slight breakdown, that's all. It's understandable considering the way you drive yourself. For a young man, Victor, I think they could take life far too seriously.
But life is serious. What man does with life even more so.
Have it your way, Victor, but there's no need to be pompous. Perhaps this will cheer you up. A new thesis in biochemistry.
That's your field, not mine.
Ah, but this work is by the great Albertus Magnus. Natural philosophy and chemical persuasion. The book is quite fascinating, and Magnus is your favorite professor.
He was.
It's quite good. You should read it. Have you already purchased it?
No.
Good.
It's peculiar that you should bring up the professor's name.
How so?
I'm just finishing a letter to
you. Oh, indeed.
I am informing the professor that I do not intend to return to Ingolstadt.
You mean, until you've regained your health?
Henry, I mean never.
Victor, is this because of your brother?
I confess that William's murder is not something that I accept easily. To live less than 10 years, when life holds out so much promise, and then to die at the hands of an unknown killer seems to me the height of cosmic cruelty.
Cosmic cruelty, Victor? The lad was murdered for an expensive gold cross, obviously by a thief of the lowest kind. Vicious and unfeeling. A monster.
Victor! May I come in?
It's my mother. Please do not make any mention of William. She holds up extremely well.
I understand.
Tell me, Mother, I'll unlock the door.
Boys together.
comrades always.
Did you hear that, Victor?
I have never doubted Henry's friendship, and I trust he shall never doubt mine.
If you could only persuade him to get out and around. My friend does nothing but lock himself in his study, as if the sound of another human voice was more than he could bear.
You exaggerate, brother.
No, Victor, I do not. He never sleeps. Don't be better within trying to do something to feed his appetite. Elizabeth has become a pointer, but I'm afraid I'm a bad patient. I do worry about you, Victor. The doctor said...
The doctor.
You shouldn't talk like that, Victor. You're a scientist for yourself.
Mother, there is a world of difference between a scientific man and a doctor.
If there is, I'm not aware of it.
One condition.
What's that?
Victor Frankenstein, who left the chateau for the university, is not the same man who returned here for sanctuary, as you call it. Something happened to him at that time. I want to know what it was, and unless you are prepared to tell me your affliction...
Yes, I intend to. I want to. I must. Henry, you are my last hope. But I'm going to tell you, we'll chill the marrow of your mortal bones.
Oh, Victor, let me be the judge whether or not my mortal bones will freeze.
If I appear half unsettled and mad, there is a reason.
If you are only referring to Ernst's visit, I can only comment that it is completely unjust to blame the messenger for the message.
You think that's why I cried out? The secret of mine rests lies here. Within those documents and papers lie the recorded crimes of Victor Frankenstein. You think whatever happened began at the university? Well, you're wrong. It began behind that laboratory door. As a boy, science and biology consumed me, as it did you. Far more than the fever that now claims my brain. I was more advanced in my studies than even you would realize. The university merely stimulated me to press on into the secret that has baffled men since the moment they first took in air.
What secret?
I have often wondered to myself, from whence did the principle of life proceed?
Bold question.
Yet we scientists are always on the brink of discovering something bold and wondrous. Our cowardice and carelessness defeat us. We restrain our inquiries in fear of what we might discover. We fear the unknown, yet long to embrace it. I had one passion and one passion only, Henry, to examine the causes of life. And to do that, I first had to recourse to death.
Death?
I became acquainted with the science of anatomy in a way that was accelerated, zealous. I observed the decay and corruption of the human body.
Yes, of course. In the dissecting room of the university.
No, I do not mean in the dissecting room of the university.
What can you possibly mean?
I mean that the charnel house became my haunt. I lived with the sense of decay in my nostrils. To me, a church graveyard was not a holy place. Only the receptacle of bodies comprised of life.
I don't believe that.
Then you're a fool. I saw how the fine form of man went degraded and wasted. I beheld the corruption of the human body until my senses no longer knew the hour, the day, the week. And then suddenly, in the midst of my darkness, a light broke in upon me. A light so brilliant and wondrous that while I was spellbound by the possibilities of success, I was astonished to discover that I alone, Victor Frankenstein, among so many men of genius, should be reserved to discover so astonishing a secret.
Not that again, Victor.
Henry, I ask for your friendship and not your skepticism.
I know you have both. Go on.
The stages of discovery were distinct and probable. Others could have found out what I did. Albertus Magnus, for one. But men of genius must match their gift with boldness and imagination, not be earthbound by the improbables. After days and nights of incredible labor and fatigue, I made the discovery, Henry. I was capable of bestowing life upon animationless matter. I discovered the cause of the generation of life.
Oh, Victor, you know that's not possible.
You think not? You too are earthbound. When I discovered so astonishing a power placed within my hand, I deliberated a long time before I decided how to employ it.
And how did you?
I began the creation of a human being.
You did what?
In a solitary chamber atop my rooming house, I kept a workshop of filthy creation.
How could you create another human being?
With considerable dedication and a strong stomach. In City Morgan Charity Hospital furnished my materials. From one I stole a hand, from another I purchased a leg. On dark nights, the graveyard proved quite productive in direct proportion to the amount of energy I was willing to expend in opening a grave.
No more, Victor, enough!
I became nervous to a painful degree. The fall of a leaf startled me. And I shunned everyone as guilty of a crime. Then, I gathered the instruments of life around my table. And when I completed my task, I fell asleep across my cot, troubled by dreams.
I should think please tell me that was the end of your experiment.
Oh, if only it could have been, Henry. That night I dreamed that I saw the grave worm burrowing in the fold of my father's funeral shroud. I awoke to my horror to see the creature that I had created with my hand looming above me. One arm outstretched as if the creature were imploring some aid. I ran from my laboratory and returned here, the sanctuary. There, now you know the secret of my rest.
I only know what you have told me.
You still don't understand?
Victor, what more is there?
Yes. Ernst, the gypsy girl, William Murder. Think, Henry, think. Ah, but this was no ordinary mortal. He was large and stitched together like a rag doll. Don't you see it? It was he, my creature made from bits and pieces of other men who murdered little William. Don't you understand? He has followed me and found me here in Geneva.
If what you say is true, which I doubt, why would he do that? Why would he murder William? And why would he hate you? You gave him life.
No, it's too preposterous. Henry, you must listen.
I've heard more than enough.
Despite what you may think, I am not mad.
Well, I think you will be if you continue on this way.
Henry, I ask for your help. Do not desert me. Henry! Henry! Devil! Murderer! Do you still doubt me? Standing here before you like a demon from hell is a proof of my infamy.
God help you.
Frankenstein, help me!
No.
No paralysis of any kind?
No.
I'm rather amazed about your eyelids, moist, lubricated by circulating tears, and the cornea is clear and transparent. Even your membranes are fully functioning. Would you mind standing up? Run in place. No, slowly. Thank you. I'm now going to test the strain of your grip. Thank you. I can see the end results are not yet cosmetically satisfactory. And there is a tendency toward hypothyroidism. But in all other aspects, you are remarkable. I myself would have thought if such an experiment had succeeded, the end result would have been a chronic kidney. I was definitely wrong for doubting Victor.
Is that all I am?
How do you mean?
An experiment.
Oh, no. Far more than an experiment, my strange friend. You are living proof that worn-out parts can be replaced. You yourself offer hope for an extended lifespan.
I am a monster, a living thing that is dead. All men shun Frankenstein's creation.
And why should they? Murderer!
Ah, Victor, did you sleep at all?
I never sleep. Not anymore. All I do is dream of horror.
Well, Victor, this is no horror. Whatever your technique, whatever it was, you have opened up a special new field of surgical study.
If one of the sadistic vivisectionists.
But look, Victor, he has complete mastery of locomotion, speech, deduction, reasoning. His parts will never wear out.
A living machine.
Yes, if you will.
Beware, Henry. The excitement in your voice betrays you. You have caught my fever.
Look, Victor, no extra fingers. No missing cartilage. Blood pulsates. His body is dug through yours and mine.
Blood of dead man.
Victor, this is no monster. You have engineered a finely tuned machine of an intricate network of muscles and tendons. The grafting is amateurish, repulsive, but it suffices.
You have forgotten something.
I shouldn't wonder.
There stands the hideous thing that has come to destroy me.
That is no longer true.
I curse the day I gave you life.
I should have expected this reception. All men hate the wretched. How I must be hated then. I did not always hate you, Mr. Frankenstein. On the night you created me, I rushed from the laboratory doors thinking that the entire world would greet me with open arms. myself no different from any others. As I watched you sleeping, I saw no great dissimilarity between the two of us.
That's disgusting.
No, it's not. You created him. It was perfectly natural for him to assume that you and he were both of a kind.
Both of a kind?
I am one of no kind. I'm outcast. Wherever I showed my face, people ran in repulsion and terror. I had no friend. In the winter, I froze in the hills. In the summer, I slept in the woods.
Were you harmed in any way? Physically, I mean.
Hunters came into the woods searching for game. I had never seen a gun or heard its sound. It frightened me, and so I ran. A great pain tore into me, and I saw my own blood for the first time. It sickened me.
Ha! Did you hear that, Victor? He felt pain. He knows fear.
As I do, Henry. As you should. Go from this house. Leave me.
Have I not suffered enough? Do you seek to increase my misery?
Is that why you come here? You seek a hiding place? Is that why you murdered a defenseless boy?
I didn't murder him, Frankenstein. You did!
You dare protect me!
A creature such as I must dare. I saw a small child coming towards me. Suddenly, the idea dawned on me that this little creature had lived too short a time to understand the true horror of deformity. If I could educate him before others imparted their prejudices, I would not be so desolate on this peopled earth. I would not be alone. For of all curses, that is the one I loathe of all others.
But why murder?
That was not my intention, at first. I seized him as he passed. Monster! He screamed. Ugly wretch! Let me go or I will tell Victor! Victor Frankenstein, my brother, will punish you!
Poor William.
I swelled with hellish triumph. I thought, I too can create desolation. This death will carry despair and a thousand other miseries to my creator, and he will suffer as I have suffered. Have you suffered, Frankenstein?
More than I would have thought possible.
Then I am satisfied. But your work is not finished.
It is finished.
You have created me. You must destroy me.
What? We are in accord, at last.
When?
Tonight.
Victor, I protest this.
Come with me, into the laboratory. You'll be safe in there until we tell him ready for you. Make no noise.
Remember, my pain is greater than yours.
Nobody ever goes in there, but just in case. Victor, you cannot be serious about this request.
Ah, but I am, Henry. Don't you see?
The creature has gone about my salvation. He'd be murdered.
Henry, you cannot murder a walking inventory of human parts.
That's absurd, Victor. You know that.
Listen, Henry. Call it anything you like. Execution. A balancing of the scale. Retribution, if you would. Anything but murder. There's blood on my hands for having created him.
And you think by destroying him now, you can wash all that blood away, Victor. Is that it?
It's my only hope.
And I appeal to you as a man of science. I no longer speak to you as a dear friend. I speak to you as one that is dedicated in pushing back the barriers of ignorance.
Barriers? I pushed back one barrier, and look at the result.
I have looked, and what I've seen is both miraculous and marvelous. He went out into the world and had every single right to expect kindness and gentleness. And yet he found that man itself is quite monstrous.
Henry, there is nothing that you can say to me that I haven't thought 100 times before. You speak of an innocent? There, look into the face of the innocent, my young brother.
Victor, I'm speaking to your intellect,
not your emotion.
Damn your intellect! Damn your emotion!
Victor! Victor!
My mother. Make no mention of this to anyone. Time to return this evening. I'll have need of your assistance.
Victor!
I'm coming.
I will enjoy the walk home. I have a great deal to think about.
Do not enter unless the door is unlocked.
You allow Henry to come and boil wilt in the garden?
That's another matter.
Neither Sophie, Elizabeth, nor I have ever bothered you about the laboratory, although at times the smell had been unbearable. However, other people must come into the study. Do not think it's fair. Let Sophie clean.
If only all matters could be reduced to such simple elements. To go shopping, to eat a breakfast, room.
Sophie has a surprise for you.
Strawberries, first of the season, Herr Frankenstein.
Leave the tray.
Hand me the strawberries, Sophie. Victor, eat the strawberries. Is that so amusing?
Mother, you're so comforting. So generous. Strawberries. Strawberries. It wasn't that at all. It's just that I was struck by the incongruity of my dark food and my mother's vicious strawberries.
They're perfectly good strawberries, sir. The man who sold them to me is reliable. I've never had any complaint about his produce.
I'm sure you have. They're delicious.
Come along, Sophie. Let's leave them alone. And you will let Sophie clean in here.
Yes. Yes, by all means, the flower market.
informed as myself will not deny herself to me. My companion must be of the same species and have the same defects as I.
No such creature exists.
You must create her.
How about you thought oblivion?
What I ask of you is reasonable and moderate.
Reasonable?
I demand one of another sex. I demand a bride to Frankenstein's creature.
You demand? You're no position to demand anything of me.
You consent, neither you nor any other living being will ever see us again.
This is ridiculous. I won't listen.
I won't. You must create a female for me who I can live with in companionship. This you alone can do, and I demand it of you as a right which you cannot refuse.
I do refuse.
Do not incite my anger.
I do not fear your anger, and no torture shall ever extort a consent from me.
We will leave the neighborhood of man forever. Please, give me a wife.
What you are asking is impossible. You ask me to create another like yourself.
I do.
To join wickedness by desolate the world.
You would harm no living being.
You are malicious.
I am malicious because I'm miserable. You, my creator, would tear me to pieces in triumph. Remember this. Why should I pity man more than he pities me? Why should I respect man while he condemns me? Let he and I live in an interchange of kindness, and I would bestow every benefit upon him, tears of gratitude and his acceptance. Why can this not be, Frankenstein?
Human sensibilities forbid it.
Do as I ask. If I cannot inspire, I will cause fear, and chiefly towards you, my enemy. Take care, for I will work at your destruction since you were cursed the hour of your birth.
There's your true nature. Malicious. Evil. Your bride would be a monster as well.
It is true we would be monsters, cut off from all the world. But on that count, we would be more attached to one another.
What happiness could there be in your lives?
There would be no happiness, but we would be free from the misery I now feel. My creator, let me feel gratitude towards you for some benefit. Let me feel that I excite the sympathies of some living being. Do not deny me my request. I do not ask this of you, Frankenstein. I beg of you.
There is some justice in your argument.
We will go to some secluded forest or jungle. My food is not that of other men. I need not glut myself on animals. Acorns and berries will suffice.
Ah, oh, noble savage.
Do not mock me.
And do not tempt me.
The sun will shine upon us as on man. We will make our beds of dried leaves. Pitiless as you have been, I now see compassion in your eyes.
Why did you have to return?
I swear, by you that created me, and by the earth which I inhabit, that if you grant me my companion, neither you nor any other living being will ever see us again.
That is what you say now. But what proof have I that you and your bride will not return, more demanding and powerful than ever before?
With another such as I, my evil tendencies will have fled.
Because you will have a bride.
Because they will have sympathy.
Forgive me for having created you.
It is too late for forgiveness. Grant me my request, and my life will flow quietly away. The moment when my time comes, I will not curse my maker.
Perhaps, as your maker, I do owe you some measure of happiness.
We will be things of whose existence the entire world is dear. The love of another will destroy the causes of my evil crimes. Pity me, Frankenstein. Pity me.
Aha! He promises that he and his bride will live away from humanity forever.
I don't know, Victor.
Henry, do it. It's not for the future's sake, it's for the sake of the experiment itself. You alone will see how the miracle of life is performed. Would you turn your back on that?
Well, when would we begin?
That's if I accept. Well, what better time than tonight? Henry, are you not dedicated to pushing back the barriers of ignorance?
Where are you going, Victor?
Where else? The church graveyard.
Son,
it shall be my warehouse of spare parts. My absolution, my salvation. Henry, I offer you a glimpse of the eternal. The choice is yours.
I accept.
Splendid. We'll get shovels from the greenhouse. Come along.
She's running the performance. There's Michael's mom. There's me and James. This is our next future mayor of Poughkeepsie. And here's the shopper, Marilyn, talking as usual. Yes, absolutely. And I'm making a commentary as I'm going along here.
Oh yeah, last week.
Did Robin leave because I was going to take a picture? Did Robin leave because I was going to take a picture?
I guess she wants to do her hair.
Oh, I got her anyway. And that's Michael's mayor teacher. What? Uh-oh.
He sits in the corner of the laboratory like a huge whipped dog. If I touch the switch, his eyes flicker to the spot.
I've noticed that.
If I rewire the apparatus, he takes careful note of how it's done.
It's just testimony to your extraordinary skills.
Testimony to his craft. You've noticed the gift of mimicry. We watch you too, Henry. A little early, I know. Studying your notes.
My notes?
I think it might be wise to devise some sort of code or other.
You say so.
It's both touching and horrible to watch him. Whenever I enter the laboratory, he's by the surgical table.
He doesn't touch it.
No, and yet he knows every molecule of his bride to be. I entered unobserved earlier and found him talking to the incomplete thing.
Really? Victor, I wonder. Where would we be at this very point in our lives if that creature was beautiful? Instead of...
Don't mistake me for a moral idiot.
No, I don't.
Leave speculations like that to philosophers. I don't want you to mistake my true motive. I believed at one time that many forms of life would bless me as creator and source, that many excellent natures would owe their lives to me.
Well, at least in one situation, that's true.
Henry, that creature is far from happy and nowhere near excellent.
Well, perhaps his bride may present a different side of the story.
These experiments with the second creature intrigue you.
Oh, yes, beyond words, Victor, you know that. Why do you bother asking?
And you feel no animosity towards him?
None towards his bride.
Because you're a scientist?
Well, why else?
Henry, you wear your badge of scientific inquiry like a coat of arms. Take care, it doesn't appear.
Well, Victor, I leave all that gloomy speculation to you. After all, you are the master.
I suppose. Still, I can't help remembering what it was like the very first time I saw his horrible form looming over. wish I could believe that, Henry. After all, wasn't it you who called the creature? Or the murderer of William vicious and unfeeling? A monster?
Yes, but we don't have time for these intellectual exercises. Unlike you, Victor, I look at the creation of this new monster from a practical view.
Henry, what could be more impractical than creating a bride for a creature that shouldn't exist in the first place?
Well, cheer up when you see what I brought you. The surgical methods I learned by your side have helped thousands of people. There is a long list of diseases in which healthy transplants would prove quite curative.
I marvel at your ability to find a merit in this enterprise.
And I marvel at your perpetual desolation, your self-induced depression. You love this creature at the same time you hate it. Victor, you have made your bargain. Stick to it.
What do you have there?
You'll see. Imagine the advantage in replacing a worn-out lung with one that is vital and functional.
In other words, my evil shall henceforth become my good.
Yes, yes. Think of yourself as a less modern Prometheus and more of a humanitarian.
Where did you get that?
The city morgue. None of the other ones did quite nicely.
Well, they did do quite nicely, but they weren't fresh. Both aspects are essential.
Yes, I think this one will be satisfactory.
Let me have it. I can't be certain. All the hands in the graveyard show signs of congenital defects. We must give the hand where the nerve, the skin, and the muscles are capable of sustaining sensation and accomplishing motion. But on closer inspection, I see she couldn't have been dead long. Good.
No, that she wasn't. But she was young. A derelict.
And there are no questions?
No. I myself made sure that the morgue keeper got his price.
I want to test it, believe that statistic.
Victor.
I warned you to stay out of sight.
How much longer?
Soon.
When?
When I decide the time is right.
Oh, by the way, Victor, when we are finished, who will name
her?
You are.
He can call whatever he likes.
You must hurry.
Must? Is that a word to use with your creator?
Frankenstein, I am a creature. I ought to be your Adam.
I see you as being more of a fallen angel.
You know, you have to be patient. We're doing everything as you have requested.
What more can you ask?
Haste!
The dawn comes so soon. Stay back into the laboratory and be quiet.
Haste. I'm gonna go run a few more tests.
Henry, you might want to take this with you. Coming.
Why do you prefer to sleep in your laboratory is something I'll never understand.
Mother, the cot is quite comfortable.
I don't know why I'm even concerned. You ignore my advice in all things.
Mother, I want to be left alone with my work. Is that too difficult to understand? I did.
And now?
Well, I'm still a deepest sympathy and passion to the living.
One might say the same thing about a piece of porcelain, Victor.
I mean my
word. I confess, my son, I have always looked forward to your marriage. It will give you strength in my declining years.
Declining years, Mother, you're still a young woman.
You and Elizabeth were attached to one another from your earliest childhood. You studied together and always been suited for one another.
Mother, what is it you're trying to tell me?
I fear, perhaps, that you view Elizabeth as a sister without any wish that she might become your wife. There, that is what I fear. And whatever lies behind that door, perhaps you have found another whom you love. Perhaps you feel proud and honored to marry Elizabeth, and this brings you pain.
Mother, I swear to you, all of my future hopes are entirely bound up with Elizabeth.
If you feel this way, marry quickly. In the sullenness of fear that takes such a strong hold upon your mind, will dissipate itself.
Oh, damn it, Victor, it won't work after all. It bruises much too easily. Frau Frankenstein.
What do you have in that fashion paper?
Oh, just an idle experiment.
With bruises?
It would be of no interest. Perhaps we should go into town. We might exchange it for another. Good idea. I'll just get my coat. Yes, you do that.
Why don't you take Elizabeth? She'd enjoy the shopping.
Or at least the kind I believe Elizabeth would appreciate.
You say so, Victor.
Mother, please, I ask that you trust me.
I try.
I'm ready, Victor. Let's be on our way. Good, then we're off.
Will you be back for lunch?
I don't know. It depends on a trip to town.
You can spare of Sophie.
And of you, and of Elizabeth, and of Henry, and of myself. But soon all of that will end.
I pray for it. Enjoy the day.
Remember, Mother. Trust me.
Thank you.
Hold the curtain. The delivery men are here again. There's a package in the hallway addressed to your son.
Where is it from?
Some chemical shop in Zurich. I think it's glass tubing.
You can go now. I'll call you if I need anything else.
Are you all right, Frankenstein?
Yes. I imagine Victor took the death of his mother hard. Are you all right?
I will be, I think.
I didn't mean for my story to upset you.
Herr Frankenstein barely spoke the word in his name. But he worked so hard, he and Herr Clarabelle.
What?
Laboratory.
And what is their project?
Oh, I wouldn't know. It's one room in the chateau that belongs to Herr Frankenstein alone. I don't know how they managed to get all the machinery.
What kind of machinery?
Wires and electrical bulbs, that sort of thing. I don't know much about such matters.
And you say he is secretive about what he's doing?
Oh, yes, that's his way. When he gets involved in his work, he's like a machine himself.
It can't do his health any good. His door is locked from the outside.
He refuses to take care of himself. Eats almost nothing.
Last time I saw Victor, I was under the impression exhausted.
That hasn't changed, I'm afraid.
It's been a bitter season for Victor Frankenstein. His brother murdered, his mother taken so suddenly. I was fond of Victor's mother, a fine woman.
Yes, sir.
You're here, Inspector General?
Well, let me just hand my tea to Cynthia, Caroline, and tea.
Thank you, Iris.
Should I make tea?
Please do so.
I'll make some biscuits, too.
And you might take care of those two kids for the rest. Your mother never liked to cry for
Poor Frau Frankenstein.
Not now, sir.
I'm sorry, forgive me. I
Mother, but they tell me she too is dead. For that I'm sorry and sorry again.
nurse. I want her to tell the story in her own words.
I wanted no part of that cross.
You know, you could have very well thrown it away.
And there's no profit in that.
And your servant said nothing to you.
I am, sir.
And I'm sure you made no attempt to harm you in any way. That's right, isn't it?
Then you do believe my story?
I am.
Choose a plan with emotions, have I know.
When will you be hanged?
Are you all right?
You still don't see the ugliness of it. The cruel shame. Now another will die because of the creature.
Victor, it's all circumstance.
She cried pity at him for life. So did he. And his word is about to haunt me. Victor, look.
My notes are almost complete. Let us be pushed on by the knowledge that at least something will come out of all of this.
You let him go? Escape?
Yes. I trust his word completely. Victor, let us let them go out into the world and find whatever Eden will have for them.
No.
What?
I said no.
What do you mean no?
You haven't lived with him as I have, Henry. Sensing his moods, his unspoken questions, knowing, always knowing that if he were ever to get the upper hand, he wouldn't hesitate to use it. Listening at the door again?
Yes.
Did you hear the girl?
I remember her.
Now another will die because of you.
You only had to point to the laboratory door, and the girl would have gone free. You remained quiet, and so did I.
Victor, when we are finished, we can see what can be done about the girl.
What can be done, Henry?
I don't know. We'll have to think of something.
Oh, so easy. Simple. We'll think of something, and if we don't...
For now, I suggest we continue on the work.
I no longer have the strength. I would advise you to seek happiness and tranquility, Henry. Avoid ambition.
Victor, that's not fair. Not fair at all. Just because you yourself are blasted in your hopes, there's no reason that another may not succeed.
I will not continue the work.
I can make you so wretched that the light of day will be horrid to you.
You have already succeeded in that.
Return to the laboratory.
No.
Continue the work.
Never.
You will not deny me my bride.
Did you hear the tone of those words, Henry? Low, threatening, dangerous. Your victim can become your victimizer very quickly. Oh, he's sly and cunning and quick. He can stroke and persuade me to best of them. But if the winds turn against him, how quickly the devil and the monster shine down.
Keep your valor. Creep me a bride. Shall each man find a wife for his bosom, and each beast have his mate, and I be alone? Are you to be happy while I wallow in despair?
Happy? How can I be happy? How can I be content when all the horror of my misguided deal stands before me, threatening an evil?
Victor, calm down.
Both of
you. Stop it! You can blast my little passions, but take care. Revenge will remain.
So be it!
I will kill you, Frankenstein!
Victor, no!
I will kill you!
Let me talk to him. Let me persuade
you.
No, you must
kill! 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 Why?
better than I should destroy his maker. I denied him his bride, and now I show the knife in my life.
It will never come to pass.
I wish I could believe that.
You must. I believe it so much to you.
Oh, Elizabeth, I am truly blessed. If only this hard vision of his return could be wiped away.
Do you recall the ancient mariner?
Coleridge? We read it once.
Only as he ran by the sea. Who is he? No one was coming.
What do you mean, Mom?
The water, the lake.
Get some smelling salts.
I don't
Why did you call out?
There are several people that we have to thank extremely for this production, and one of them is sitting right in front of me, hello Carrie, and I'd like you to stand up and come up here, because we have a gift for you, and because we couldn't have done this without you.
Supervisor of our drama club, that without we, this none of this could have happened. This is, Estes, could you come up here? And last but definitely not least, our great stage manager who did very, very much, and who we also couldn't have done anything without, Catherine La Puente.
And we'd all like to thank you all very much for coming, and it's very wonderful to see you all here. And I hope to see you back again at our next production. Thank you.
Been responsible for the incredible lighting and sound that we've had, rain up in the spotlight. Basically, that drew me to let the husband who helped with the flash.
Might I add, Miss Estes can play a wicked game of cards.